because they are newcomers to our conferences, events, I should say that the first surprise that we get is that we start on time. Because I know that how you think and what your perceptions are about Athens and Greece. And you say, you know, who knows what time they're going to start, who knows what time they're going to finish, and who knows whether the last session today takes place tomorrow. So, despite all these misconceptions about our conferences, stigmatized by the maybe bad faith that Greece and Athens and Greece have since antiquity, it's true, so the faith. We are late, we are not well organized. As Professor Pappas, our Vice President, will explain since antiquity, maybe this is the reason why culture. Good morning to everybody. My name is Gregory Papanikos. I'm the president of what we call a World Association of Academics and Researchers. Unlike the World Series in the United States, that all the United States participate in our conferences, it's truly, they are truly world conferences. People come from all over the world. And as you will see in our formal presentation, we have members from over 100 different countries. Now, what I'm going to say is a few words about, as they come in my head, my clouds, using Plato's dialogue. I'll say a few words, and then Professor Pappas, our Vice President, will say more in a more structured form. Now, as you can see it there from the funeral oration by Pericles, it was a very good for a tourism attraction. So they would say that was the motto in all times to attract tourists or Perikites, people that they would travel around and see. They were advertising Athens as a city that people can come from all over the world and see and learn. Of course, at the time of the 5th century, Athens had more than, or 4th century, Athens had more than 40 schools, or what you can call the academic institutions, based upon private fees, that's where they copy-paste from the American institutions, and of course, based upon the leader of the school, like Aristotle, or Plato, or the cynic of Diogenes, the sophist. So they had their different schools, but they're in downtown Athens, actually, where they were located, and we know now where Plato's Academy is, and where the Aristotle's equivalent is. We have found the location, not the building, so. The location, you can see it. Now, what we try to do at the Athens Institute for Education and Research is to copy-paste that model. So we want to make Athens a place where people from all over the world, they can come and exchange ideas. Copy-pasting a model is not easy, re-engineering it and making it adaptable to what the modern world provides. It was very difficult to copy, for example, the organization of a symposium. So it's very difficult for those that they know and they read the symposium by Plato to, or any symposium of ancient Athens, to copy-paste exactly what took place during those symposiums. So we took only the ones that are adjustable to modern ethics, to say the least. And so we're not going to force you to do things that violate your ethical code. Now, the idea was small groups. So when they had the symposium, a conference, the word symposium now in the Western thought at least is identical with conferences. Usually it might include only small conferences. But the idea of a symposium is to get together in a room, going around 24, 40 people, and then start talking, not all of them, for less than, as I count in the Plato symposium, that they were the proceedings that came out after 30 years, and now it's called Plato symposium, they had only 8 speeches. Now, and they were saying that there were 8 more speakers for an entire day. Pretty much what we do here. And of course they selected the best speeches, the best papers, and Plato included it in a conference proceedings paper. But you can see, trying to see the analogies of the copy paste. So that was the idea, to organize something that was organized in downtown Athens, 2,500 years. And this is the reason why a lot of Americans, they don't read, usually they don't read, neither our mission nor our policy. When they come here, they expect to find thousands of people attending the conference, even though we mentioned the letters that this is a symposium, it's a small event. It's not thousands and thousands of people. And hopefully, by the end of the day, still we have a double digit attendance, which is 10, by the way. because some people may not understand that. They think it's 100. So we have double digits depending upon the weather conditions and other amenities that Athens have. This is the basic idea. Now, it is very difficult to implement in an environment that is characterized since antiquity by uncertainty, by risk. Since I'm an economist, I use terms that they have a very specific meaning for me and might not have the same meaning for you. But it's very difficult to start something on time in Athens, at least, as I said in the beginning. Very difficult to finish the session. This is the reason why we have chairs, as Professor Pappas will explain, and this is an old problem of how to who is going to chair the chair? That's the old question. Who is going to rule the philosopher kings? That's a very tough question. Now, most of the chairs, they don't follow our rules. They invent their own rules during the session. Now, this is usually leads to catastrophe, chaos, anarchy, whatever Greek word you want to use. But please, the only thing that I can do is if you have this internal, what I can say, urgency to follow and implement your own rules. First of all, there's nothing new in Athens. Every Athenian does the same one, so don't bring something new into the city. But if you have this internal urgency, the only way that we can help you is by decapitating. We can change. Ask our researchers and administrators so they can change this, because there's no other way that we can run the conference smooth. So there's another reason why, even though Professor Pappas will not say that, but there's another reason why we're doing that. As you have noticed, those that they are old, they might understand it, they noticed it, that English is not the only language in the world. There's other languages. And of course, we have maybe more than 200. And as my vice president told me in the office once, that we have a definition for these people that they speak three languages, they are called trilingual. Correct me if I'm mistaken. People that speak two languages, they are called bilingual. And people that they speak one language, they are called Americans. there are other languages other than English. The reason that we adopt English here is because, unfortunately or fortunately, it's an international language and everybody can understand. That would be ancient Greek, of course, or sign language. So we make the conference very cumbersome if we have a language that nobody understood in the first when they use interpreter. Now, English has been chosen for this reason, and I know a lot of people in the linguistics, language, philosophy, would say what I say, that it's crazy, but the choice of the English language doesn't necessarily imply that we accept political, cultural, social, or whatever connotation might be implied by the use of English. So this is the reason why we want the questions at the end. Some people, they don't want questions during their session because they don't speak English. They have prepared their presentation, they have concluded and said, we know that. But they are scared, in some cases, that it's their first presentation in English. Don't look at me that I have no nose, because my English is my mother tongue. That's the best English accent we ever hear. Yeah. I know that you cannot imitate, but you can try. But please make sure that we create an environment that is conducive to understand different cultures that we have here, people that do not speak English, and help them, especially if you are a chair, by not asking questions. People you will see when they go outside, if you see someone that trembles, a PhD student, and you know, goes like that, and his, her English, don't ask questions that use strange adjectives, for example. Now, even yourself do not understand. Ask very simple adjectives, you know. Don't use 18th century, what I say, English, because it's a matter of interpretation how you use the word. And don't make life tough for people that do not speak English very well. Now, the way that we do our stuff, we have academics here that are responsible for the conference. They don't know anything about administration. We do not ask. Second, we have administration out there that you can ask them whatever you want in terms of making your stay easier. Okay. And each room has a reception and helps the chair. That's the boss of the chair, the guy that stays inside, you know, and checks that everything runs smooth in terms of PowerPoint presentations and sometimes time, and assist you with all the administration. I don't think I have more to say. Professor Pappas will do a more formal presentation than mine. And I wish you a nice day, and I'll be around. So if you really want anything that you can ask about the Singaporean meeting, that's what I know very well, about Trump, that's the issues that I can discuss with you. Not what time the boat is. Thank you very much.
I'm Vice President of Academic Membership, and I'd like to give you a little bit of a rundown of what our organization, our association is like. We use the term associate, we use the term institute instead of association formally, so that people can work on writing this off, okay, or doing whatever they want. That's one of the things, you know, we have to think about your finances as well. Of course, this is probably one of the, you'll find it on our webpage. If you haven't been to our webpage, please visit it. It has a host of different things for you to look at. I'll mention them as I go along. This is on our webpage. Our city is open to the world. We never expel a foreigner from learning and seeing. This was at the time of Athens' height, middle of the Peloponnesian War, and yet this whole idea of being open has been very important to Athens since time immemorial. And here's another view of the Athenians, which is very interesting, and it links with us. And the other Greeks have pretty much the same dialect, lifestyle and dressing style. But the Athenians have an amalgam of all Greeks and barbarians. In other words, barbarian was a term used for foreigners. It meant somebody that babbled or blah, 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 blah. But it didn't have the negative, necessarily the negative connotation that it does today. It's cultured Persian. And a wild Celt would be called a barbarian, just for the heck of it. They have another word, Xenos, which is a little more positive. So, the Greeks considered the Athenians, and this was written by Pseudo-Xenophon, who might have been a Greek that went to Sparta. And there, he says that the Athenians are a mix. The Athenians loved to learn new things. And here's a quotation from Plutarch, biographer and philosopher of the first century AD. Neither Greek or Athenian, but citizen of the cosmos. And he was talking about Socrates. So Athenians don't necessarily consider themselves just citizens of their own particular location, but citizens of the world and perhaps the universe, if you want to look at it that way. But who is Greek and Athenian? And pretty much, and perhaps Greek you are called because of our common pedagogy rather than our common descent. So the importance there is pedagogy, education. And all of us are educated, so in a way we are all Greeks. So when you're coming here, you're coming home in many ways. All right? Now, this is Antiner's mission. And Gregory put it best. Antiner aims to create an organization like Plato's Academy and Aristotle's Lyceum, where academics and researchers from all over the world with a pedagogy similar to ancient Athens, because our modern education system has in part its foundations from ancient Athens. And they can gather in a symposium type meetings to exchange ideas on their research and discuss future developments in their disciplines. Here's some facts about Antiner. We have over 2,400 members from 116 countries, organized into 37 units, 7 divisions, and 5 centers. In fact, our organization resembles a university. We have colleges and departments, if you want to look at it that way, except we don't have students. We have researchers and academics instead. About 6,000 scholars offer their services as reviewers and referees from 150 different countries. People who haven't been here have helped us out. Every year, close to 2,000 researchers present their papers in one of Antiner's conferences or other events. In total, more than 20,000 researchers have come to Athens and presented papers at one or more of our conferences since 1995. Basic activities of the organization: international conferences and symposiums, academic dialogues, public speeches, and roundtable discussions. We also assist in hosting courses in Athens accredited by other universities, quite a few over the years, but not on a regular basis. There are some of the universities we've had participate. We also have autonomous summer courses. If interested, please let us know. We also try to conduct research. We've had a number of cooperative efforts, but often it's on the members' initiative, and external funding has to come from the members' initiative. We also host visiting researchers. If you're on a sabbatical or a leave, you can come and use our offices as a base. The only thing we ask is that this is self-funded, your trip. Our publications include, some people wouldn't call a publication, but in a way we come out with it on a regular basis after the conference. 4 days after the conference, we come up with a collection of the abstracts that are presented at the conference for people's records. Some people go further than that and actually present a paper to us. Those papers are often uploaded in a Antiner's conference presentation series based upon your submission. Then from there we have the online paper series based on a submission and reviewing. And we've had over 200 books published from various conferences, usually collections of essays. And we've had over 865 authors and editors of these books. And finally, what is the most exciting is our collection of e-journals. We have 15 e-journals edited by a number of scholars from the United States and elsewhere throughout the world. In 2016, the acceptance rate of these journals was about 20%, less than 20%, but the denominator needs better papers. So please, if you want to submit your paper, please do so. We would love to see it. We've come out with, been active for 5 years, we've come out with nearly 20 issues for each of the journals. So take a look at them. One of the nice things about these journals is that they're free. You go on to Antiner's site, go to the journal site, you can download any article there in PDF. We believe in information, at least to be open. And that's an important thing. We don't want to deny people an effort to have their work published. And this is the best way of publishing as far as we're concerned. Now, how can you get involved? Become a member. You are a member when you register. You have a little sheet that you fill out. You are a member of Ontinet. If you don't come, don't worry about it because there's usually no fixed cost, but perhaps a small annual fee. Now, as a member, you can do several things, and this is very important because we want to make it more member-driven in many ways. And you can organize a stream. In other words, take a theme and run it through a conference. You can organize a panel or a session in which you get together with other scholars of your discipline and form a panel with you as chair for one of our future conferences. This is very important because this is member-driven affiliations, which is very good. We have more thematic panels that way. We don't have a bunch of independent papers in one panel or whatever. You can get together with people and organize your own session. We would like you to, if you can, review or submit papers for publication. You can also consider organizing a summer course from your university, bringing your students over here, and Ontinet will help you on the academic side. We can't promise you all the facilities, but we can help in many ways. And if you wish, submit or suggest something else, pending you have the money and time to implement it. We will give you some organizational help. Paper presentations, this is very important, because this is how we run our conferences. It's a tight ship. Each paper is allowed 15 minutes maximum. Rhetoricians, paper presenters, can use less time if they so wish. And we'd be really pleased to see that. Questions and discussion are after all papers have been presented and not after each paper. Gregory mentioned the reasons behind that. Chairman will use 3 minute and 1 minute reminder cards because we follow Socrates' suggestion from Plato's Protagoras. Elect a judge, Rafukon. Rafukon is a person with a little club. Yeah, because if you ever look at images of the Olympics, the referees have a stick and they beat cheaters with it. Okay? Or a foreperson, an epistate, or a chairperson, a pritani. So you keep the length of each speech, each one's speech short. For technical assistance, contact the administrative representative before the session commences. In other words, if you have a PowerPoint or you need some other element, please check with technical assistants, our representative, or actually our researcher. There are more than just paper presentations. There are additional pedagogical events. Some people might not consider this pedagogical, but I do. See and trust only social program information page and only ask administration. Don't ask me. Don't ask Gregory. We are academics. We are founts of misinformation. Okay, so be careful. Among these activities are Greek Night, which is on tonight. It's a wonderful venue on top of the Hellenic American Union. You see an outstanding view of the Acropolis at nighttime. There is food, there is music, there is dancing. It's a great time. We also have tomorrow in the morning, we're having it in the morning now so we can avoid the summer heat, an urban walk conducted by Professor Gregory Katsas, and he takes you on a 3 kilometer tour of downtown Athens. You visit the columns of Olympian Zeus, you visit the Acropolis, you visit other elements of both ancient and modern Athens. It's a great tour. It gives you an interesting view of the city from not only the point of view of history, but sociology as well, and culture.
We also have island tours on occasion. We've been having a strike recently, so we had to adjust these tours. I'll talk about that briefly. We also have a visit to the old cult center at Delphi. And what we've done with regard to island tour is we have a trip to Mycenae, the old capital of Agamemnon from the Trojan War. We also, on this trip, invite you to go to the island of Poros. Sometimes there are also trips to ancient Corinth and Cape Sunio. So take a look at your social program and see if any of these interest you. Enjoy the conference. Thank you very much. Also, just want to make one other comment. We have found that having smaller conferences work much better, because at a big conference, you're lost in a crowd. At this conference, you get to know people. And that's one of the things that's kind of unique about this, because you meet people from all over the world. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.